justice, the doling out of punishment, our way, though flawed, of paying back someone for committing evil acts. Sometimes we punish an innocent person. Sometimes the truly evil ones slip away. It's all we flawed human beings have, however, so we cling to it and hope, one way or the other, that evil is punished. I firmly and devoutly believe that all humans will reap what they sow. It just sometimes takes a while. Like, say, a century.
Commonplace, if somewhat grim, unsocial event known as a necktie party. The guest of dishonor, a cowboy named Joe Caswell, just a moment away from a rope, a short dance several feet off the ground, and then the dark eternity of all evil men. Mr. Joe Caswell, who, when the good Lord passed out a conscience, a heart of feeling for fellow men, must have been out for a beer and missed out. Mr. Joe Caswell, in the last quiet moment of a violent life.
Reverend, no need, I ain't interested in prayers.
And you're a mortal soul, Caswell. Are you interested in that?
It's my mortal neck that concerns me now. And it's gonna be your pleasure to see that it's stretched a couple of feet. Since that book ain't gonna help, might as leave make it short and get it over with.
Judge?
You got anything to say? It's your right, you know.
That's my right, is it, Judge? The young fella I put a hole in had too much mouth, not enough brains. I'd invite him out again tomorrow if I had it to do all over again.
You shot my son in the back, Caswell. And that's a long country mile from an invitation to a showdown. Now, if that's all you got to say, I got this to add. I'd like it to take a while. I'd like you to feel it, Caswell. The more you kick, the more justice I figure there is in the world.
Execution was directed by David Orrick McDearman and written by Rod Serling, based on a short story by George Clayton Johnson. Though undeserving of it, our spotlight shines on one Joe Caswell, played by Albert Sami. He is a violent murderer mere moments away from his execution. After the exchange we saw, the judge tells him that he's a terrible and evil man, and this hanging is a service. Just as the horse is shooed out from under him and he is to meet his fate, he suddenly vanishes right before the eyes of those standing around him, leaving an empty noose. In the next scene, we see him laid out on a sofa, clearly in a very different environment. As he comes to, he's greeted by a scientist named Professor Mannion, played by Russell Johnson. The professor explains that he has built a time machine and used it to pull Caswell out of 1880 and into the present day of 1960 to test his machine and learn about the past. He offers to treat Caswell to the gifts of the future and show him what life is like right now. Mannion also reveals that he essentially pointed his machine at random and has no knowledge of who Caswell is or what he has done. Whoops. I find that really hard to believe. Is it just pure chance then that he got a person at all and not just like a tree or a bird? This is apparently the pick random answers on my multiple choice quiz method of time travel. Anyways, in a dictation machine late one night, Mannion shares his thoughts on the man he's brought forward, saying that there is something about Caswell that just doesn't sit right with him. Not to mention, there's this strange burn mark around his throat. Eventually, the professor discovers the rope burns around Caswell's neck are from a noose and puts two and two together, realizing Caswell is not the nice guy that Mannion was hoping to invite into the future.
This came at the end of a rope, didn't it? That's where you were when I reached back into time. You were at the end of a rope, weren't you, Caswell? 6 or 8 feet off the ground, and I got to you in that one fraction of a moment before your neck was broken.
When you're dangling at the end of a rope, it don't matter whether you're 1 foot off the ground or 100.
You killed someone.
A whole territory full. I stopped counting after 20. Well,
I'm going to have to send you back.
Caswell, unsurprisingly, does not want to return to the noose, and the two break out into a struggle. Mannion grabs for the pistol in his desk, but Caswell beats him up good, eventually killing him with the professor's desk lamp. Instinctively, Caswell grabs a dead man's pistol and runs out into the streets. Completely overwhelmed by the noise and strange technology, Caswell stumbles from place to place, randomly shooting things. He shoots at a jukebox playing music. He shoots at a television set playing a western. He shoots at a car in the street. You get it, right? He shoots things. This goes on for a really long time, like 8 minutes of the episode. It's really obvious they're padding this out, and this segment saps much of the tension from the beginning. It honestly feels like two completely different stories lazily slapped together. Anyways, after shooting everything he reasonably can, he runs back to the professor's apartment and collapses on the floor, pleading with the corpse to help him. Am I supposed to feel bad for him? He confessed to murdering 20 people without shame, and then killed the man who saved him from death. A moment later, another lowlife slips in through the door.
I thought the place was empty. Just move away from the desk, cowboy.
What do you want?
What do I want? What do you want, Buffalo Bill? Well, that's what I want, whatever's around loose.
This is Paul Johnson, a burglar who has randomly chosen this place to ransack. Caswell attacks him and knocks the gun away from him, but Johnson manages to get the upper hand and, rather poetically, strangles him with a cord that pulls the drapes by the window. Once Caswell is dead, Johnson proceeds to wander around the room, looking for valuables, before stumbling into the professor's time machine and being sent back to Caswell's time. And unfortunately for him, Caswell's noose.
Well, cut him down, hurry up, cut him down.
That ain't Joe Caswell. That ain't the guy we hanged.
Look at his clothes. What kind of clothes are they?
Who is it?
This is not Caswell, Reverend. It's a stranger. What kind of devil's work is this?
I don't know. I don't know if it is devil's work.
Did we hang an innocent man then?
I hope not. I pray to God not.
This is November 1880, the aftermath of a necktie party. The victim's name, Paul Johnson, a minor league criminal and the taker of another human life. No comment on his death save this. Justice can span years. Retribution is not subject to a calendar. Tonight's case in point, in the Twilight Zone.
Sometimes, Twilight Zone plays with a really good concept, only to drop the ball with the actual implementation. On paper, this sounds like a really cool idea. A criminal gets pulled into the future and finds he can't get away from justice, and another criminal takes his place at the hanging. I also enjoyed seeing the scientist come to the horrible realization that his messing with time has spared a criminal from an execution. Though I admit, even this is dragged out a little past believability. So all the pieces are in place, but clearly, we realize that it wasn't enough to fill 25 minutes. You can practically see the point in the episode, around the 10-minute mark, where the interesting stuff has all happened and the episode still has about 15 minutes to go. It catches itself at the end, bringing both scumbags to justice, but unfortunately for the viewer, you can't just pick and choose which scenes you get to watch. Now, What You Need, episode 12, suffered some of the same problems in terms of not having enough material, but what it did have, it used masterfully. Here, I really think the writer has backed himself into a corner with the settings and characters chosen. Would it not have been more interesting to have had this episode be about the scientist, as he struggles morally with the consequences of his actions? What if he had tried to send him back, but messed up somehow and made it worse? Or maybe it didn't work, and he had to bring him to justice himself. Instead, the most interesting asset this episode had dies in the first act, and we're left with grunting cowboy man for the rest of the runtime. A perfect example of good concept, bad execution, pun intended. I give this episode 1 out of 3 fedoras.